Hi, gang. I've been asked a lot how to make an amplifier for a crystal radio, one that plays loudly on a speaker. As you can see, I got a little fancy and made a permanent one in this jar. I'll show you how I made it, step by step, and how you can make one, too. I originally saw the circuit from this good book. It uses an LM386 amplifier chip. When I looked up LM386 online, the first document I found was from the chipmaker's website, Texas Instruments. And in that document, I found the very same circuit with additional details about the chip. The book information and the website link are in the description below this video. Here's the circuit for my crystal radio, and here's the earpiece that's used to listen to the radio. That's the part that this amplifier replaces. And here's the amplifier circuit it gets replaced with. And this is how I arranged it all on my perfboard. I'll be following that step by step. Here are the parts you'll need. First, the capacitors. Two 10 microfarad electrolytic capacitors, a 0.1 microfarad ceramic capacitor, two 220 microfarad electrolytic capacitors, and a 0.047 microfarad ceramic capacitor. For controlling the volume, you'll need a 10 kilo ohm potentiometer or a variable resistor. The volume will be controlled by turning the knob. Mine is audio tapered or log tapered. The alternative is linear tapered. The type of taper tells you how the resistance or volume in this case changes as you turn the knob. Here's a graph showing you a linear taper. You can see that when the knob is turned halfway, the volume will be at half. But in this audio or logarithmic graph, when the knob is turned halfway, the volume will be around 16%. At least that's what I got when I measured my audio potentiometer at what looked like halfway. Audio ones exist because of the way humans tend to expect volume to change as they turn the volume knob. You'll also need a 10 ohm resistor, a simple on-off switch, a 9 volt battery and some way of attaching to the battery, a small speaker, usually one that's 8 ohms. This is a permanent magnet type of speaker, which I took from a toy electric guitar. And an LM386 amplifier chip. My local electronics store didn't have an LM386, but they had an equivalent one called NTE823. If you can't find an LM386, just look for an equivalent or replacement part. I didn't want to solder directly to the pins on the chip, so I got a socket for plugging it into. I'll solder to the socket's pins instead. I want this one to be permanent, so instead of doing my usual breadboarding, I got this perfboard for soldering everything onto. And now for how to make it. The first thing I did was to quickly plug it all into a breadboard to test it. The placement of the holes in the perfboard matched the holes in the breadboard exactly, so it's easy to move it all permanently to the perfboard afterward. The whole thing will be mounted inside this plastic jar, so taking into account the breadboard and the size of the jar, I marked the perfboard and cut it. The battery will be mounted on the board, so I drill out some larger holes and use some tie straps to hold the battery in place. I pull them only tight enough to hold it, while still allowing me to slide it out for replacement. I'll start with the chip. Looking closely at it, you'll notice it has 8 pins. And in this corner is a round dot. That dot means the pin at that corner is pin 1. From there we know that this is pin 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on up to pin 8 right here. I'll be soldering to the socket and not the chip directly, so I put the socket in the perfboard, in a place that corresponds to where the chip is in the breadboard. On the back I bend a few of the pins to hold it in place. On the breadboard, this row of holes is all electrically connected together. I use that row for connecting to earth ground and battery negative. So I make a mark on the perfboard along the corresponding row. Put one end of a red wire in this hole, and the other end in this hole. Make sure there's plenty of bare wire on both ends for soldering to things. That'll connect pin 6 to battery positive later. Put one end of a black wire in this hole, and the other end in this hole. That connects pin 4 to ground. While we're at it, connect a wire from this hole to this hole. That connects pin 2 to pin 4, but remember, pin 4 is connected to ground, so really we're just connecting pin 2 to ground. Put one end of a red wire in this hole, and another in this hole. Later we'll be putting a few other things in these holes to connect them together, so pin 5 will be connected to them too. And let's do a similar thing by putting a wire in these holes. That'll connect pin 8 to something else. That something else is this 10 microfarad electrolytic capacitor. Since it's an electrolytic capacitor, it has a positive leg and a negative leg. The negative leg is indicated by this stripe or minus sign here. Put the positive leg in this hole next to the red wire we just put in. Put the negative leg in this hole next to pin 1. So in the last two steps, we just connected pin 1 to pin 8 through this capacitor. We did it in two steps because the chip will be in the way. It's getting a little crowded back here, so I'll solder a few things together to make room. To save on headaches later, after each solder, I check it with a magnifying glass and my meter. The solder joint was successful, so I trim the excess wire and move on. And here's the result after this batch is done. Put the 10 ohm resistor in these holes. That connects one end to ground. Put the 0.047 microfarad capacitor in these holes, oriented either way. That connects it between the 10 ohm resistor we just put in and pin 5. And to finish off that area, get one of the 220 microfarad electrolytic capacitors. Put the positive leg here and the negative leg here. That connects it between pin 5 and the speaker, which we'll put in later. Next, put the 0.1 microfarad capacitor in these holes, oriented either way. That connects it between pin 7 and ground. And lastly, for that side of the chip, take the remaining 220 microfarad capacitor and put the positive leg here and the negative leg here. That connects it between pin 6 and ground. Take the remaining 10 microfarad electrolytic capacitor and put the positive leg here and the negative leg here. That connects it between pin 3 and the middle of the potentiometer, which we'll connect next. The potentiometer has three legs to connect to, so I solder a black wire to this leg, a yellow wire to the middle leg, and a red wire to this leg. The wires have to be fairly long, since this potentiometer will be mounted in a hole in the side of the jar. To connect it up, I put the black wire here, the yellow wire here, and the red wire here. That connects the black to ground, the yellow to the 10 microfarad capacitor we'd put in during the previous step, and the red will go to the crystal radio's output later. I'll put a very long red wire in the hole beside the red wire we just put in from the potentiometer. That will be going out a hole in the jar for connecting to the crystal radio's diode. Next, for the speaker, I'll put the black wire here and the red wire in this hole here. The polarity doesn't really matter. That connects the speaker between ground and the negative leg of this 220 microfarad capacitor we put in earlier. I soldered some long wire to two legs of the switch, because the switch will be mounted in a hole in the jar somewhere. I'll put one wire here, and the other wire here. That connects one end to the red wire that goes to pin 6, and the other end to the battery positive, which we'll do next. This is the connector for plugging into a 9-volt battery. I'll put the red wire, which is battery positive, into this hole, and the black wire here. That connects the positive to the switch, and the negative to ground. As you can see, I've been soldering and testing connections as I went along. The last thing to do is solder all these ground wires together. For that, I prepare a long wire with a long piece of insulation stripped off it. I put it in this hole and bend the bare part to reach all the parts that should be grounded. And here it is, all soldered. Now I can insert the chip. Remember to pay attention to the dot on the chip that tells you where pin 1 is. And that's it! Now to mount my crystal radio amplifier in a jar. First, I permanently put on the tie straps for holding the battery. Then I make holes for the potentiometer, or volume control knob, and the on-off switch. Then I make a nice big hole in the cover for mounting the speaker. I also cut two slits in the side for the wires connecting to the crystal radio. I put everything in place. I hot glue the speaker in place. I also attach alligator clips to the wires for connecting to the crystal radio. I painted the jar black and made some nice labels for the volume control and switch. I fastened the potentiometer and switch and screw on the cover. Done. Time to have some fun. Here's my so-called indoor crystal radio. I first connect the red wire to the crystal radio's diode. Then I connect the black wire to the crystal radio's ground. As you can hear, it's fairly loud. Now to try out the volume knob. And here's my portable crystal radio in a pizza box.
It's weird, it's wild, it's free! The International Busker Festival, August 2nd through the 5th on Spark Street.
Well, thanks for watching. See my YouTube channel, rimstar.org, for more videos like this. That includes one showing step-by-step how to make your own indoor crystal radio, and another showing how to make a portable pizza box crystal radio. And for variety, see how radiation works using an americium pellet from a smoke detector as an example. And don't forget to subscribe if you like these videos, or give a thumbs up, or leave a question or comment below. See you in a bit!